All right, today we're going to look at Neil Armstrong being interviewed by Sir Patrick Moore, aka Games Master. And we're going to pose the question to Mr. Armstrong, did you really go to the moon? But first, let's have a quick gander at the gadget's first question, shall we?
Mr. Armstrong, I do realise that when you were on the moon, you had very little time for gazing upwards. But could you tell us something about what the sky actually looks like from the moon, the sun, the earth, the stars, if any, and so on?
The sky is a deep black when viewed from the moon, as it is when viewed from cislunar space, the space between the earth and the moon. The Earth is the only visible object other than the Sun that can be seen, although there have been some reports of seeing planets. I myself did not see planets from the surface, but I suspect they might be visible. The Earth is quite beautiful from space and from the Moon. It looks quite small and quite remote, but it's very blue and covered with white lace and of the clouds, and the continents are clearly seen, although they have very little colour from that distance.
Aye, and remember, Mr. Armstrong has got to hear the right stuff to be able to go into outer space, and must have the physical and mental capabilities to win the Krypton factor twice over in one day. So when the Gadget's descriptive words and experience is no better than the Russian space dogs, I go investigate. Aye, here comes the science bit, right? In order to find out if Mr. Armstrong is telling the truth, we're going to use two methods of experimentation. First method, we're going to measure his physical reaction to the questions, in this instance, the Gadget's eye movements. Take a look at this picture diagram. When a person is accessing real thoughts, sounds and emotions, that person will look to their left in an automatic response in retrieving that stored information. And so, when a person is looking to their right, that person is constructing or fabricating images and sounds, and at the same time trying to empathise with the lie, while constantly checking themselves for validity and continuity. They say the bigger the lie, the more the brain has to work to formulate the sequence. Therefore, this creates an automatic response and behaviour which can be measured. Method 2 is a psychology method called linguistic text analysis and has four key features. 1. Liars often reference themselves less when making deceptive statements. 2. Liars tend to involve others and disassociate themselves. 3. Liars explain things in the most simple terms. 4. Liars will often paralyze with long drawn out patterns of speech. And finally, liars will often come prepared with an antidote or story to pad the lie. I'm going to call this the commode theory. Keep this in mind for later. And aye, just in case you were wondering, Mr. Armstrong is indeed right-handed, so we'll be continuing with our experiment. Cheers.
Mr. Armstrong, I do realise that when you were on the moon, you had very little time for gazing upwards. But could you tell us something about what the sky actually looks like from the moon, the sun, the earth, the stars, if any, and so on?
The sky is a deep black when viewed from the moon, as it is when viewed from cislunar space, the space between the earth and the moon. The Earth is the only visible object other than the Sun that can be seen, although there have been some reports of seeing planets. I myself did not see planets from the surface, but I suspect they might be visible. The Earth is quite beautiful from space and from the Moon. It looks quite small and quite remote, but it's very blue and covered with white lace and of the clouds. And the continents are clearly seen, although they have very little color from that distance.
What about the sun? Do you see any trace of the corona?
No, the glare from the sun on the helmet visor was too difficult to pick out the corona. The only time we could see the corona was during an eclipse of the sun from the moon, that is, when we were flying through the moon's shadow and could observe the the solar corona peeking out from behind the moon.
Looking at the photographs that you brought back, the colored photographs of the moon's surface, it seems that the color of the surface actually varies according to the angle from which you see it. Is this so? Does it do this?
Yes, it certainly does. It's a characteristic that we observe first while traveling around the moon in orbit. You could see that at the terminator, at the boundary between the black part of the moon and the lighted part of the moon, it was as if you were looking at a television set with the contrast turned full contrast, very black and very white. As you moved further into the light, there were more and more shades of gray. But as you moved further, such the sun was higher above the horizon, you actually start to see the tans and browns appear, although at a very low level. Similarly, on the surface of the moon, the same characteristic is evident. You can see browns if the sun is high enough. Apollo 12, for example, landed while the sun was only five degrees above the horizon. So when they arrived, they saw no browns or tans anywhere, only fairly high contrast grays.
But you did.
Yes, I did. The sun was 11 degrees. And Apollo 12 did also. The next day, when they arose from their sleeping period and the sun was higher, of course, then the browns were observable to them.
When you were actually walking about on the moon's surface and kicking about a certain amount of dust, did you notice any local color? And also, were you at all subconsciously worried about the possibility of unsafe areas?
Well, the color is a puzzling phenomenon on the moon, aside from the characteristics that I've already mentioned. You generally have the impression of being on a desert-like surface with rather light-colored hues. Yet when you look at the material at close range, as if in your hand, you find it's a charcoal gray, in fact, and we were never able to find any things that were very different from that color. I suspect that as we get more and more samples with future flights, we will see that there is, in fact, some color, but the optical properties on the moon are most peculiar.
When you were actually walking about, did you have any difficulty in distance judging? Because I think I heard you say once that near afar things looked quite near.
Yes, we had some difficulties in perception of distance. For example, our television camera, we judged to be from the cockpit of the lunar module only about 50 to 60 feet away, yet we knew that we had pulled it out to the full extension
right.
of Pause a 100-foot cable.
Pause the video. Right. Watch this two-minute clip from the motion picture Reservoir Dogs. This may put things into better context for you. 2 minutes.
Use the commode story.
What's a commode story? It's a scene, man. Memorize it.
What?
Look, man, an undercover cop's got to be Marlon Brando, right? To do this job, you got to be a great actor. You got to be naturalistic. You got to be naturalistic as hell. Because if you ain't a great actor, you're a bad actor. And bad acting is bullshit this job.
Yeah. What is this?
That's an amusing anecdote about a drug deal.
What?
Something funny that happened to you while you're doing a fucking job, man.
Damn. I got to memorize all this? That's over 4 fucking pages
Look,
of this
man,
shit.
Just think about it like it's a joke, all right?
You memorize what's important, the rest you make your own, all right?
You can tell a joke, can't you?
Nope.
Pretend you're Don Rickles or some fucking body and tell the joke, all right? Now, the things you gotta remember are the details. It's the details that sell your story. And this particular story takes place in a men's room. So you gotta know all the details about the men's room. You gotta know if they got paper towels or a blower to dry your hands. You gotta know if the stalls ain't got no doors or not, man. You gotta know if they got liquid soap or that pink granulated powdered shit they used to use in high school, remember? You gotta know if they got hot water or not. If it stinks. If some nasty, low-life, scum-ridden motherfucker, man, sprayed diarrhea all over one of the bowls. You gotta know every detail there is to know about this commode. So what you gotta do is to take all them details, man, and make them your own. While you're doing that, you gotta remember that this story is about you. And how you perceive the events that went down. The only way to do that, my brother, keep saying it, saying it, and saying it, and saying it, and saying it.
Yes, we had some difficulties in perception of distance. For example, our television camera we judged to be from the cockpit of the lunar module only about 50 to 60 feet away, yet we knew that we had pulled it out to the full extension of a 100-foot cable. Similarly, we had difficulty guessing how far the hills out on the horizon might be. Peculiar phenomena is the closeness of the horizon due to the greater curvature of the moon than we have here on Earth, of course, four times greater, and the fact that it is an irregular surface with crater rims overlying other crater rims. You can't see the real horizon. You're seeing hills that are somewhat closer to you. There was a large crater which we overflew during our final approach, which was it had hills of the order of 100 feet in height, and we were only 1,200 feet west of that hill, and we couldn't see a 100-foot high hill from 1,100 to 1,200 feet away.
Did you notice any obvious difference between the far side and the near side as you went around it? I mean, apart from the obvious differences in topography.
No observable differences in color, but then the sun's angle was always somewhat different over there, so it would be difficult to make a general correlation. Mm. I would say the topography is the striking change. Yes. Of course, as all your viewers know, there are no seas on the far side of the moon, and it's all highlands and high mountains, big craters. So it's strikingly different from the
There's just one more thing I'd like to ask you. You're one of the very, very few people, I think, whose opinion on this is really worth having. In fact, there are only four of you. Do you think, from your knowledge of the moon, having been there, that it is going to be possible in the foreseeable future to set up scientific bases there on anything like a large scale?
Oh, I'm quite certain that we'll have such bases in our lifetime. Somewhat like the Antarctic stations and similar scientific outposts, continually manned. Although certainly there's the problem of the environment, the vacuum, and the high and low temperatures of day and night. Still in all, in many ways, it's more hospitable than Antarctica might be. There are no storms, no snow, no high winds, no unpredictable weather phenomena that we're yet aware of, and the gravity is a very pleasant kind of place to work in, better than here on Earth, and I think it would be quite a pleasant place to do scientific work, and quite practical.
Mr. Armstrong, thank you very much, and again, let me say what a tremendous honor and privilege it's been to have you with us.
Cheers. Here comes a science bit. Right, Mr. Armstrong failed on every aspect of his eye exam, and it's worth noting that not even once did I record Mr. Armstrong retrieving real stalled information, and secondly, showed classic linguistic responses associated if someone was lying, which draws me to the conclusion that Mr. Armstrong didn't go to the moon and, believe it or not, lied. This video may not come as a surprise to some folk, but entertaining the idea that we have been lied to doesn't compute with most people. And it would be at this point I'd encourage you to go research on this topic. Just type in NASA deception, or check out a gadget called Bart Sabril and his videos, A Funny Thing Happened on the Way to the Moon and Astronauts Gone Wild. We only just touched upon this, and I'll definitely do more videos on NASA in the future, right? And remember to subscribe and leave your thoughts in the comment section. Cheers.